Hello and welcome to this lecture. We're going to talk about covariance and correlation. And once again, this is a topic you've seen in Statistics 1. But nevertheless, we'll just quickly go through and discuss these ideas once again in this topic with some new perspective. So we've seen variance before, expected value of a random variable, and then we saw variance, and then we saw that variance was a measure of the spread of how spread out the values are likely to be if you observe a lot of repeated observations of the random variable, and expected value was like sort of the center of one random variable. Now, what if you have multiple random variables, say two? Okay, we've seen one, but what if you have two random variables? Then you might want to have measures which relate the two random variables. Individually, you can have variance and standard deviation and expected value for each of the random variables. And can we have a measure of the two random variables combined in some way? Okay, so those are things like covariance and correlation. So let's get into that. So brief motivation. So supposing I mentioned we're going to look at two random variables. So let's say we look at two random variables x, y, which have a joint PMF which looks like this, right? So x takes values 0 and 1, y takes values 0 and 1. And here are two possible joint PMFs. In one case, you notice, this is the values taken by x. So this is x. And this is y. And here is a joint PMF, half, 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 half. And then, okay, so it's not half, 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 half. That's not a joint PMF. It's 1 by 4. So apologies for that. So this is wrong. It's 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4, 1 by 4. Okay. So if you look at the marginal, right, so if you look at fy and then fx, you will get half, 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 half. And interestingly, the marginal here is also half, half. Okay. So notice how the marginals are the same. Just looking at x and y, both these joint PMFs, seem to give you the same marginals, but actually their distribution is very, very different. In one case, it's, all four possibilities are likely. X can be 0, y can be 0. In the other case, if x is 0, y is only 1, right? So there's no possibility of y being 0 itself, right? So in this case, so it's these are two completely different joint distributions giving the same marginals. So, and we would like a measure which maybe can give you the difference between these two sort of situations. And so once again, let's repeat that here. And this is wrong. It has to be 4. Okay, so here is the observation. So mean and variance, if you just look at mean and variance for x and y, you're going to get the same answer for both these joint PMFs. And the joint PMF is so different in this case, right? So x and y are independent in one case, the value of x determines the value of y, right? If I tell you x is 1, then you know y is 0, right? Likewise, if x is 0, then y is 1, okay? So that's true in the second case. In the first case, x and y are independent. If x is 0 or 1, y is just uniform, half, half. Okay. So how do you quantify something like this? How do you come up with a measure which sort of quickly tells you, how two random variables behave? Are they sort of independent, tending towards being more independent? Or is one going to determine the other? Are they, very closely connected? So is there a nice measure, one number, that can come up with that can quantify this, right? So we quantified center of a random variable, we quantified spread of a random variable. Now we are going to quantify this relationship between two random variables. Okay, so that's the idea behind covariance. Okay, so let's see the definition. The definition is easy to write down. You have x and y being random variables on the same space. The covariance of x and y is denoted COV brackets x comma y, and the definition uses the expected value. Okay, so the expected value of x minus e of x times y minus e of y. Okay, so that's the definition, very simple definition. Okay, so supposing this, so let's just look at the definition and see intuitively if we can figure out what it means. if covariance of x comma y is positive, right? So see, remember this is just a number, right? X and y will be a distribution. So this guy is just a number. After you evaluate the expectation, covariance is just a number, and it could be positive, negative, or zero, right? If it is positive, then what is inside the expectation we are saying is positive, okay? So x minus e of x times y minus e of y is going to be positive. So if it's positive, then each of the terms x minus e of x, if x minus e of x is positive, then y minus e of y is also going to be positive, right? So roughly, you know, I mean, when I say, notice the word I've used tends to be positive, its expected value is positive. So we are expecting, you know, quite often maybe it's positive. So then if x minus e of x is positive, then we are expecting that y minus e of y is also positive, okay? So what does that mean in practice, in a rough sense? If x is above its average, right, x is above e of x, then you expect y to be above e of y, okay? X higher means y will also be higher, okay? So rough, I mean, these are just rough remarks based on what the definition is, just to get you to intuitively appreciate why these things are defined in this fashion. On the other hand, if it's negative, then we expect x minus e of x times y minus e of y to be negative. And so if x minus e of x is positive, if x is above its average, then y minus e of y is going to be negative. So y is going to probably tend to be below its average. Okay. So these are all just probabilistic statements, but hopefully you get the picture. Okay. So this one number, covariance of x, y, sort of represents whether x and y tend to be high together, or one goes high, the other goes low. Right. So that's the sort of impression that's good to remember. If covariance is zero, there is a no definition here. X and y are said to be uncorrelated. Okay, so it's an important definition to keep in mind. If covariance of x, y is zero, we say x and y are uncorrelated random variables. Okay, all right. So that's just the definition. Let's evaluate it. For some cases, before we evaluate, let's just look at positive and negative covariance a little bit more, once again from an intuitive point of view. I'll throw a few examples at you, and let's see if we can sort of intuitively argue whether we expect the covariance to be positive or negative or maybe even zero, right? So let's say x is height of a person and y is weight of a person, okay? So generally, if a person is taller, okay, then they also tend to be heavier, right? So just the height gives more weight. Of course, there are exceptions to this rule, so it's just a probabilistic statement, but we generally expect that to be true. So in this kind of data, we expect covariance of x, y to be positive, okay? This is not a rigorous statement, it's not a problem as such, it's just an observation of how to think of these things when they show up in practice, okay? Here is another thing, rainfall during monsoon and the debt of farmers. If you want to look at those two variables, if the rainfall is higher, then the farmer's debt is going to be lower, right? So hopefully, okay? So covariance in this case, you expect to be negative in some sense, okay? Here is another example where covariance is negative. I've been looking at this IPL over a lot. If you want to think of runs in the over and wickets in the same over, you probably expect this to be negative, right? If there are more runs, then maybe the wickets were lower, okay? So this is just to build up your intuition a little bit before we get into the mechanics of evaluating the correlation and covariance. But in most cases, we won't be dealing with these kind of very, you know, high level problems. We'll be dealing with very simple problems. What are simple problems? A problem where the PMF is given to you. Okay, x is given, y is given, and then the PMF is given to you. Here is a PMF. How do you go about computing covariance, right? So this is the sort of problem that's given here. So let's go ahead and do this problem, right? So this is the joint PMF of x and y, and we have to evaluate this expected value. So notice covariance of xy is expected value of x minus e of x times y minus e of y, okay? So one very direct way to do it is to actually find e of x and e of y, okay? How do you find e of x and e of y? One can find the marginal, so maybe, you know, so let's see if we can find the marginal. If you do fy here, you have to add it up, so you see you get 1 by 3. Okay, so this needs to be 2. Oh, once again, I've messed up this PMF somewhere. Apologies for that. So this is not a valid PMF, it's not a 2. 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2. So you have 6 of them, 12 plus 3, 15. Now this is a valid joint PMF. So you have 1 by 3, 1 by 3, 1 by 3, So here again, you have 1 by 3, 1 by 3, 1 by 3 for the marginal distribution of x. Okay, so that's good. So if you look at the marginal distribution of x and y, you see E of y equals 0, right? Because it's minus 1 with probability 1 by 3, 0 with probability 1 by 3, 1 with probability 1 by 3. So E of y is 0 and E of x is also 0. Okay, so when E of x and E of y are 0, it becomes really nice to evaluate this expression. So it's just expected value of x, y. So you just do x, y and then multiply with this probability. So if you do that, this just becomes, you know, minus 1 times minus 1 times 1 by 15, right? And all these 0 multiplications will not play any role, right? So, I mean, 0 minus, you know, 0 times anything is 0. So, I don't have to bother with all the values where either x is 0 or y is 0. Only the other things matter to me. And then you have minus 1 times 1 times 2 by 15 plus minus 1 times 1 times 2 by 15 plus minus 1 times 1 times 1 by 15. Okay, so if you do this, you get, you know, this is 1 by 15, 1 by 15, that's 2 by 15, minus 2 by 15 is going to cancel, so you get minus 2 by 15 as the overall covariance, okay. So this kind of calculation you should be able to do, okay. So given a joint PMF, a very small joint PMF, you should be able to evaluate the marginals, find the E of x, E of y. Once you find E of x, E of y, plug it into this and evaluate the covariance. And if E of x and E of y are not 0, then you will get slightly more complicated things, but it doesn't matter, right? So every possible x and y, you just go through and multiply by the probability and do the calculation. It's a straightforward computation of expected value, okay? Hopefully this was clear. So this is how you go through and compute it. Of course, you can argue that all the 0 values have dropped, but they don't show up in the summation, right? You'll have terms of the form like, you know, 0 times minus 1, that's already 0. I don't need to account for it. Okay, so we've got a sort of a small negative value, okay, for this. Does that make sense? Does it make sense that, you know, if x tends to be high, then y will tend to be slightly lower? Maybe, I don't know. You can look at these numbers and sort of guess and see that, you know, x and y are equal with some lower probability, and you know, if x is 1, then y is likely to be minus 1 and 0. And if x is minus 1, then y is likely to be higher. So it's sort of going opposite. So negative sort of makes sense. Okay. Okay. So this is sort of a bread and butter problem, right? Given a joint PMF, evaluate the covariance. Just go through, do it mechanically. Okay. So this is one problem. So few properties. How do we consider? You know, are there some simplifying properties? Are there some easy ways to evaluate covariance? It turns out one can write it in a different form. We'll see that. The first thing is, if instead of covariance of x comma y, if I put x comma x, I end up getting the variance of x. Okay, so that's a simple little result, a good property to remember. Okay, so in covariance of x and y, if you make y to be equal to x, you will get the variance. And variance, as you know, is non-negative. It's going to be positive and all that. Okay, while covariance can be either positive or negative, variance will only be positive, and this comes from this very simple observation. Here's another expression for covariance, okay. Instead of writing expected value of x minus e of x times y minus e of y, you can write it like this. If you found expected value of x and expected value of y, you can simply find expected value of x, y, okay. So this form I really like, right. So this is the form in which you can easily compute. You have to find expected value of x, y, expected value of x, expected value of y, and covariance is simply expected value of x, y minus expected value of x times expected value of y. Okay, so it's much easier to use this formula. There's a little proof here you can go through and see. It just goes back to linearity of expectation. Like I said, keep using linearity of expectation so much. Okay, and the fact that e of x and e of y are constants, right? So if you use that, everything will sort of work out to this kind of an expression. Covariance is symmetric. It's very easy to see. This is the product. Whether you do it this way or that way, you get the same product. X, y, and y, x have the same covariance. Okay, simple properties for covariance. Okay, it's also a linear quantity. Okay, so unlike variance, which involved a square, there's no square here. Okay, so if you keep x as the same, and instead of if you look at ay plus bz, then it is just the, you know, linear combinations of the covariance. Okay, the a and b come out, and you can use this kind of an expression. So, this kind of linear property is very useful. It's easy to prove, and it goes back once again to linearity of expectation, and it everything follows from there. Okay, I'm not going to prove this property, but this you can use sometimes to simplify your covariance computation. Okay, so now let's look at the connection between correlation and independence. Okay, so we saw how if covariance is very small or if covariance is zero, we say that the random variables are uncorrelated. We also saw another measure called independence, right? So, independence was a much stronger measure of how two unconnected two variables are, right? So, if you remember, the joint PMF has to become the product of the marginals for independent random variables, and not only that, any event you define with one random variable should become independent of any event you define with another random variable. It's a strong requirement, but these two are connected in one interesting way. So, the first thing is, if x and y are independent already, then they are uncorrelated. The covariance between x and y will become equal to 0. Okay, this is an important thing to remember. Okay, so if you are already independent, then you will be uncorrelated. Your scatter plot will look all over the place and all that. So, it will be uncorrelated. Okay, the proof is actually quite easy. Expected value of xy is equal to expected value of x into expected value of y, and so it will cancel with minus that and it will go to 0. Okay, but the converse, what is converse? Suppose x and y are uncorrelated, do they have to be independent? That's a question you may ask. It turns out they don't have to be. Okay, so even if x and y are uncorrelated, they may be dependent. Okay, so the important thing to remember here is this independence is a much stronger notion of being unrelated to each other than being uncorrelated. Uncorrelated is a slightly weaker notion. So independence implies being uncorrelated, but you can be uncorrelated but still be dependent. You may not be independent. So converse is not true. So here's an example, a very quick example. You can come up with various other examples as well for uncorrelated random variables, but maybe it's a bit of a surprise to you. So, if you just have a range of 2 for x and a range of 2 for y, it turns out you cannot have an example of this type. Uncorrelated will be independent in that case. But if you increase the range of x to 3, you know, make it minus 1, 0, 1, and the range of y to 0, 1, it's very easy to come up with examples like this where the random variables are uncorrelated, but they will be dependent. So, here's a quick example. Let's do this calculation. If you look at fy, you're going to get, half and half, right? If you look at fx here, this is 3 by 8, 1 by 4, 3 by 8, okay? So, clearly, immediately you see, because of this 0 or anything else for that matter, but 0 clearly says, it's not equal to half into 1 by 4 clearly, right? So these two are dependent. Okay, we know they are dependent. Easy to establish. Okay, so the 0 not being equal to half into 4 is very easy to see, but you can also see other things. So many other things will satisfy this. For instance, 1 by 4 is not equal to 3 by 16, 1 by 8 is not equal to 3 by 16, things like that, right? So you can see everything is this is not independent at all. Okay, but let's compute the correlation. You see the expected value of y is half, right? Expected value of x is 0. And then if you do expected value of xy, x is 0, y is 0, all this will go away. So, only these two will matter, and that's minus 1, this is plus 1, and you can see you'll get 0 again. So, you see expected value of xy equals expected value of x times expected value of y. So, x and y are uncorrelated, but they are dependent. Okay, so here's a simple example that you can do. So this other property that I mentioned, I think it's true. You can check it out. If you only have two possible values for x and two possible values of y, I think you can't have this property of being dependent but uncorrelated. I think it's not possible. You can check it out if you don't believe me. But if you just increase the number of alphabets for x to 3, you can quite easily come up with these kind of examples of dependent but uncorrelated random variables.